Hello and welcome to Brubacher and Beyond podcast, where we are shaping the world we live in so more people can find the construction industry uncommonly refreshing. My name is Kristen Lovage, Director of Business Development at Brubacher Excavating. Today's episode, we are talking about suicide awareness in the construction industry. I'd like to introduce our guest today. I will start with our online guest, Lisa Paskey. Could you introduce yourself, Lisa?
Hi, absolutely. Thank you very much, Chris. My name is Lisa Paskey. I am with Personal Assistance Services. We are an employee assistance program, and I'm a licensed clinical social worker, as well as a manager of account services here at Personal Assistance Services.
Thank you for that. And also like to introduce Keith Brubacher.
Yeah, hello. Keith Brubacher here. I serve as president of Brubacher Excavating. We're delighted to have these other folks here with us as well. They're all connected to us in one way or another. Chris and his role here in the business, and Lisa as part of our EAP program that will be beginning their work with our company here in just a few months as we welcome their services. And then our next special guest, Chaplain Larry. Larry?
Hello, everyone. Yes, I'm Chaplain Larry. I served as a pastor for nearly 30 years, retired from that recently, and been transitioning into this role as on-site chaplain for Brubacher and Trinity. So delighted to serve in that role.
And if I recall correctly, Larry, you've just recently started a role as chaplain at another business as well, where you're serving part-time in a number of businesses, helping support their teams.
That is correct. Yes, I've been delighted to be able to do that, and also been other companies reaching out to me to inquire about what does this look like, maybe to begin a chaplain service in their business as well. So it's fascinating.
So you can soon work night and day, as if there's that much. It sounds like there's a lot of demand.
Yes.
So that wouldn't be good for your own wellness.
And I always misspeak and say Pastor Larry, but Chaplain Larry. If you haven't listened to past episodes, Chaplain Larry is technically not an employee of Brubacher, but is funded through the Brubacher family. So if there is any needs internally through Brubacher employees or team members, they can reach out to Chaplain Larry, and it's totally confidential. So there's that great support through that. So let's get into the discussion today. There's going to be a lot of talk in the construction industry about this. It is our second season, and this is our second time we're talking about this, suicide prevention in the construction industry. And for the research that I've done, it's been an issue for an ongoing time now. But really, in 2016, the CDC did a report, and they determined that you're four times more likely to die from suicide compared to the general population if you're in the construction industry. So there's a lot of things that support that, but that's what we're going to talk about, is what are some of the things that we do to support our team members. And with, you know, these situations, Lisa and Chaplain Larry are a support team, right? But the suicide rate for construction workers in the U.S. is approximately 53.2 per 100,000 workers. And I know a couple years ago that if you looked at the suicide rates, were higher than people actually getting hurt or injured on the job. So it definitely is a problem that the industry is facing, and there's some things that the industry is trying to do. And those are the things that we're going to talk about today in this. So, Keith, would you like to talk a little bit about what Brubacher does in the commitment to helping our community?
Yeah, and it really starts with a culture of valuing life, and abundant life is what we want to do our best to help create an environment where that can flourish. Obviously, there's lots of challenges that get in the way of that we all experience, and they vary from person to person and even at different times throughout our lives. So that starts, first of all, with our commitment to safety and ensuring that our team members are protected from hazard on the projects we're working in. There are a wide range of those, but certainly we want people to go home and be able to enjoy the rest of their life, family, relationships, et cetera, and to be able to someday retire from here or somewhere in the industry and have all their body parts and their capacities with them. And so that's very obvious from a physical standpoint, but oftentimes it's easy to overlook. And I think the construction industry is particularly notorious for this, where we tend to focus on the external and the kind of the tough guy mentality and overlook what's on the inside. And that is just as, and even more important, because it impacts someone's actual ability to be safe on the job site, to have the presence of mind, to stay out of harm's way, to make good decisions. And frankly, if people are in a position where they're facing less hopefulness in life, they may be more likely to take risks, drive a little faster, take a little risk, take a shortcut. I know for me, when I'm frustrated or if I'm at a low point in life, it has already in my life changed my risk profile. So as a company, from the safety standpoint to the how we create opportunities for others to receive the support that's needed when life is difficult, obviously you can't force that, but we want to provide the opportunity, the resources, the connections, whether it's through third-party partners like Lisa's described in her role, and we'll hear more about, whether it's through Chaplain Larry, whether it's through a caring supervisor or a coworker. I've had guys that were in the cab of their machine and they're pouring out their heart about stuff going on, and they wanted to tell me about it. That's a pretty big barrier, just positionally. So the more that we can create opportunities and the idea that it's okay, not only is it okay, it's necessary for us as human beings. We are human beings, and in construction, we focus on the doing, but we're not called human doings. And so if we can help to create that environment and foster that it's okay, that we can have these conversations in confidence, then I think we've done more than just shape the surface of the earth, but we've actually shaped our impact in the lives of people. And that's what I'm passionate about. How can we have a positive impact in the lives of people shaping our communities?
And Lisa, can you provide an overview of the challenges in the construction industry that workers face to mental health?
Sure, absolutely. So, and you're exactly right, Keith. It is all about being very present and being aware. And there's a lot of things that go into our mental health, but it also impacts how we think, how we feel, our relationships, and that's any relationships, work relationships, personal relationships, familial relationships. Our mental health contributes to everything, and it contributes to how we physically feel too. So by focusing on the mental health, it's so important. Now, some of the challenges within the construction industry are just like you said, that male persona, that male macho, if you will. I don't know what else to call it. And it is a male-dominated industry. So there's some of that. I think one of my peers likes to say some individuals come from the era that if you're hurt, rub a little dirt on it and it'll be okay. And you just keep moving forward. Some things you have to give yourself some grace and give yourself some patience to be able to focus on what needs to be focused on. Some of the construction jobs can lead to isolation, too. Separation from family, from friends, from routine, and they're long days, and that impacts sleep. So all of those things are factors. So that sleep deprivation is huge. If you don't get enough sleep, or if your sleep is impacted, you're not going to be functioning on all cylinders. You know, another piece of that is some of it is seasonal and cyclical work. So there's that up and down and that unpredictability of that. That also leads to high stress levels. Another thing is it's very riddled with chronic pain because of previous injuries, because of the physical nature of what people do in the construction industry. Sometimes they take medication for their chronic pain. Those can be opioids for after an injury. And sometimes that leads to an overabundance of using substances, which can impair definitely our mental well-being as well. And it's an industry where it's a little more tolerant of alcohol use, especially. So, and I'm not saying that everybody has to give up alcohol in order to be mentally well, but these are things that are certainly contributing factors. The other thing is witnessing accidents. That can take a big toll on someone's mental health and maybe some subsequent PTSD that results of that, but certainly stress reactions that happen from that. And the stigma, just the mental health stigma. Like you said, the Center for Workplace Mental Health did a study with construction workers, and the top 4 reasons that individuals didn't ask for help, with the highest being shame and stigma. That's huge. So anything, like you said, Keith, that a workplace can do to create a culture where it says it's okay to ask for help, that's huge. The next in line was the fear of the judgment by peers. So people want to know that it's a judgment-free zone that they have. 55% said fear of negative consequences. So knowing that just because someone may be having a rough day, or maybe their anxiety is a little harder to manage today, doesn't mean that their job is in jeopardy. Now, not focusing on what you need to do to be well can cause accidents and create a safety issue, but it's not because of what you're feeling, it's because of the actions that follow that. And then for a lot, it's also don't know how to access care. So it's really important that everybody is aware of all the resources that are available to them. There's just a lifestyle too, for construction is really hard too. You're on the road a lot. Again, the long hours, the shift work, all of that. So just the lifestyle is more prone to not eating healthy and not being a healthy lifestyle, which can also impact our mental well-being too.
Wow, that makes it a little bit into perspective. I mean, when you get into the construction industry, you think about all the good things, right? Like you build something, you can physically see it being built. You can move that dirt. You can see the project when you're driving by, but there are a lot of stresses that go into that. So we talked a little bit, Larry, about your position with the organization and your past 30 years of being a pastor. What is it like when you go out into the field?
What's it like to go out into
the field? Yeah, give me a day in Chaplain Larry's when you're out in the field, and you know.
Getting out into the field is one of those things I need to work at doing more of. So getting out into the field, I feel like I'm just in the beginning stages of learning to develop relationships with individuals in the field. I know more people here in the office and the shop. And so, but going out in the field, it's making a goal of learning to know one new person in every job site you go to. Mm-hmm. And so to just develop relationships, that is my goal, to develop relationships. And then as you develop relationships, that opens up the door down the road for other discussions about whatever may be on someone's mind, which could be a wide range of things.
Yeah.
I think you hit the nail on the head, Larry. It's about that connection, that human connection. That is so, so important. You know, we live in a world of tech right now, and there's a lot of tech out there, and tech has its place. It certainly does. But nothing beats the human connection. Nothing beats serving soul to soul. Nothing beats that human person that you can talk to and have available to you.
One of the advantages of construction, you know, we hear a lot about challenges finding tradespeople, et cetera, and underinvestments in that training area over the years. But one of the things that construction offers people is a chance to work together as a team, typically. There are some roles that tend to be more isolated. You mentioned that isolation can indeed be one of those, especially if someone's traveling out of town. Some construction involves out-of-town travel. For us, that's a minority of our work. But for many companies, there can be isolation from family and friends, but there is this kind of teamwork, and like a utility crew, those 5 or 6 people probably spend more time together 50 hours a week than they do with other groups of people in their lives over the course of a year. And the question is, so what's the quality of those relationships, and how can we come alongside of them and help those be ones that are more likely to be positive in their lives and ones that are life-giving to them?
So one of the things, though, and I was doing some research on this, and Psalms 34:18 came up. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. So how do you offer hope, or in working with people through your past, how do you make that connection through the spiritual connection to the real life connection? Or
one of the things I discovered is that people can reach out. Or if maybe there is someone has attempted to take their life, then there seems to be a lot of focus on the emotional, physical, and there's less focus on spiritual. So I think understanding there's a large role that faith and spirituality plays in this is key. I look at it as an upstream prevention. What I mean by that is, I've heard it said at one of the workshops I attended, suppose you were standing by a river and you saw all these people coming downstream who were struggling and they were drowning and you were there, you were rescuing all these people, but wouldn't it make more sense to go up the river, upstream, to see why people were falling in the river? And so I think that's the part that spirituality plays, is you get upstream and begin to talk about those spiritual aspect of life, because I believe that everybody is seeking a number of things in life. First of all, meaning and purpose, which includes who am I, why am I here, but also people are seeking peace as well. And so I believe that God, the creator of all mankind, is the answer to finding those keys. And there's only one place where you're going to find peace. Most people think of peace as the absence of conflict or the absence of chaos, nice and peaceful, quiet. I'm talking about a peace that you can have in the midst of all the chaos, the dysfunction, the turmoil that you have inevitably going to encounter in life. And that only comes from one source, and that's through Jesus, and he can give that to us. It's a supernatural kind of peace that even in spite of all that's going on around you, you can experience that peace. In your mind, where you can lay your head down on your pillow at night and sleep without your mind going 1,000 miles an hour, lay your head down your pillow at night and sleep, and also that peace that filters down into your heart and gives you that peace that everybody's seeking and searching for, but most people look in the wrong places for.
Yeah. Well, I think you brought up something interesting there, Larry, that in that, as you described that, it doesn't mean that suddenly, oh, life is great, everything's the way I want it.
Correct.
It's something that happens internally that changes our outlook on the very same situation that's confronting us the next morning when we wake up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So how do I inject or include spirituality? It's part of the conversation. When someone comes and talks to me, then I listen. And then inevitably, we go to that. So how does God fit into your life? And just pursue that question. And maybe that could be piece of the puzzle that we're looking to put together.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Mm-hmm. So if people, you know, some people outside of Brubacher listen to this, hopefully all over the country, but Lisa, what kind of resources are out there for people in need? Or if people know somebody in need, what do you recommend?
Well, there's a couple of different things you can do. Certainly, if you're listening to this and you are working an employer or you are an employer, make sure that you are communicating well about the employee assistance program. If you're an employee and you're not sure who your EAP is, ask. Just ask. That is real important. One of the things that I always suggest, and I've done this when I've been on construction sites too, is I've said, take your phone out and put, for us, it's put our number in your phone. If you need it, it's there. If you don't need it, that's okay too, but it's there for you. So giving individuals direct access to the resources that are available to them and communicating about what the resources are, that's huge. That's huge. Because remember, a good chunk of individuals who don't access care are because they don't really know where to find the resources. So you kind of have to prepare for that ahead of time and say, here are where you can find the resources. There is also national resources that are available to you. And I believe those are going to be on a screen for us. So there's a wide variety of national resources that are out there that cover just about every single population that's there. The big thing is, don't be afraid to reach out and talk to someone as an individual. If it's you or if it's someone you know, someone happens to make a statement to you that has you questioning their thoughts or that they're not feeling well, mentally well, extend a hand and just, you know, be there. You don't have to fix it for them, but just let them know you're there and you're listening and that you hear them and being very present with them. That is huge. People want to know that they have your undivided attention when they're going through something like this. So no matter who you are, you can provide that level of peer support, if you want to call it that, that level of support that you can have. We also call it psychological first aid. So you got a first aid kit when someone gets a cut and you put a Band-Aid on it. There's also psychological first aid that you can do. Be present with the individual, just have a conversation with them. Give them your undivided attention. Don't leave them alone. That's too important. Don't leave them alone. Get them a glass of water. If they're saying, hey, I got to hurry up and go get the kiddos from school, maybe someone else can get the kiddos from school, or someone can ride with this individual or take this individual to get the kiddos from school. Just being present. Sometimes that's what's needed. Sometimes that's what's needed, but know what resources are available. That's for the individual. And as an organization, just like Keith was saying, take those steps to create that culture where it's okay to ask for help. It's okay to not be okay, as Keith said. It doesn't mean you're a bad person. It doesn't mean that you're broken. It just means that right now, this is a bit of a challenge in your life. And having those resources, training leaders, training individuals to recognize some signs and symptoms that maybe someone isn't 100% mentally well right now is good also. And having those programs in place like Toolbox Talks and those kinds of things are available to help.
So with one of the resources we have is Chaplain Larry, Keith, but what are some other resources that we have inside of Brubacher?
Yeah, well, I think within the organization, certainly the EAP, the Employee Assistance Program, many employers either are required to have that or choose to have that. And I think there, as employers, we really got to ask ourselves, am I doing this because I need to check the box so I'm compliant? Or am I doing this because I really care about our people receiving the highest level of care? And then looking at that utilization and say, so what are the barriers and how can we reduce those barriers? And, you know, I look at that and think, well, okay, we don't know who, we just know there was five people that reached out or six or whatever the number was that year. And I think, here's this resource. Surely there's needs. I hear about them. I know about them. I experienced some of them myself. I've reached out to our EAP myself for my wife and I, for a situation that we were dealing with in our larger family. And so I think part of that is whether it's EAP, Chaplain Larry, or speaking out to a friend or a coworker, I think we have an important role to play in being transparent about our own challenges. And I'm not saying, you know, air your dirty laundry with everybody you meet, but there's a way to be transparent about, I may be the president of the company, or I may be a supervisor, it's well respected, or I may be a truck driver, or whatever my role is, to think of ourselves as we are equal as human beings. And I think that outside of any program, outside of any number to call, as important and necessary as they are, to the extent that we can be real as people of influence, we have a greater opportunity to impact those around us. That helps reduce some of those barriers. So I think that one of the most important things we can do, and that I try to do and model, is that posture of transparency around that. And so for me, it's kind of personal. And I've shared this with our team in various venues where on both sides of my extended family has been touched by mental health challenges. I have an aunt who unfortunately felt there was no hope and ended her life. And her husband works here and has been an important part of our family and our business here for a long time. And that really hit home. And I realized that when there's not access to the care when you need it, and even if you have a great network of people around you, life can still seem very overwhelming. And there's oftentimes maybe there's a chemical imbalance going on. There may be a physical piece, relational, certainly the spiritual, which Larry talked about. And I think we got to be really careful not to assume that, oh, this person, you know, because of this, they have this issue, this challenge. We got to be really careful not to judge in that way. So I think those are things that we can do and how we can be that makes the difference. And then it got more personal for me a number of years ago. We had some very, very difficult business conditions coming out of the Great Recession. And I wasn't sure what was going to happen. And I was leading the company, and nobody wants to be the guy that screws up the family business under their watch. Certainly didn't want that to be me. And there was some long, grinding, dark days, months, and years. And I found myself at a point where I thought it looked like life might be simpler if I wasn't here. And it took me a while to get to the point where I could talk about that with other people. And I think it's important that those of us that have experienced that and come through that are able to be transparent and not get hung up on what title's on our business card. And I hope that that's one of the most important gifts that I can leave to our team here and to the listeners of this podcast, is that recognition of how important it is to have hope. And I had to ask myself, what's my source of hope? Is it within me? Is it, or is it in my circumstances? Or is it something external and eternal to me? And I found that answer, that except for the mercies of the Lord that are new every morning, I have no greater reason to live than to experience that each morning. And I'm grateful that the Lord helped me see that, and that I have a loving family that helped me through that.
That's amazing, Keith. Thank you so much for sharing that. It's these personal stories and personal testimonials like that that really mean a lot. Because I think, to your point, if someone in your position, I'm sure that there's a lot of people that look up to you at the role that you have in your family, professionally, in your community, maybe, and to know there's a lot of validation that comes with the fact that, wow, if Keith was feeling this way, then maybe I'm not as broken as I thought I was, because someone else is actually feeling that way, someone that I look up to and admire. The other thing too I want to point out is that sometimes it's not as easy to find that hope. And so the step becomes reaching out to somebody that can help you find it. There's no shame in that. There is no shame in that whatsoever. As a matter of fact, it's not a weakness, it's a strength. It is a strength to be able to say, hey, I need to reach out to have someone assist me with finding it. You still had to do the work. It's just a matter of having someone kind of guide you or put you in the direction of what might be helpful to you. The other thing I want to tack on there too is, you mentioned the people around you too. And I think that that's huge. Whenever something happens, when there's an event like a suicide or anything that kind of shakes the normalcy, if you will, it's important to not only just focus on the individual, but the people around them. So if there's an event or a death in the workplace, it didn't even have to happen at work. It impacts the whole team. And that impacts mental well-being too. So don't try to scoot past that or sweep anything under the rug. Address it. Let it be vocal. Put it out there. Have a conversation about it. That also helps create a culture that says it's okay to talk about these things. It's okay to talk about how I'm feeling. And that's where some of the healing comes in too. And you want to have the professionals present to be able to help that, whether it's the chaplains or the pastors or the counselors. Have someone who knows and who can be there and be present to help individuals, what we call process through it. Because if you bury it, it doesn't get addressed and it's just going to bubble up later. But if you're processing through it, you're actually working through it to help sort out what's going on within you so you can find that glimmer. Find that hope that you're looking for.
Yeah, thanks for sharing that, Lisa. I think it's a really important point to remind us that we need to work with people around us that are equipped and care to get to the root. And that does take time. You know, I've heard it said, however long it took you to get into a situation might take you just as long or sometimes longer to get out of it. And so often, I think in our quick fix society, you know, the 10-second TikTok clip, microwave, we want a quick solution. It's so easy to stop at just addressing the symptoms. I fix the symptom. And and that's why I said for me, I know it was really important to inspect and think about, well, where is my hope and who am I really? And in fact, who am I if Brubacher Excavating does not exist? Who is Keith Brubacher and what is his role on earth? And how can I find meaning in that? So I think it's so important to do as you just outlined and really work to understand the root. Again, whether it's chemical, emotional, spiritual, usually they're kind of like the iceberg. What's on the surface is only part of the 80% that's down below that waterline. And, you know, we don't like to let a lot of people see that.
It's like an onion. When you start peeling it, when you start peeling off things, that you get to the core of that onion, for sure.
Yeah, I think the other thing you mentioned got me thinking, get to a place where you can get help. I think one of the crazy things about this whole situation of mental well-being is if there's something obvious that was physically impacting someone's ability to work or to perform their functions, and we saw they had a broken leg or something, we would certainly see that they got help. We might call an ambulance. We might take them to the hospital. We would find some way to help them. And yet when it comes to mental well-being and suicide prevention, we don't even think about it, first of all. And then if we do think, oh, it'll be fine, just, you know, shut the door, go to work, and I'm sure it'll be fine. By the way, what do feelings have to do with it? And we can tend to minimize it when it's just as impactful, and maybe more so, than something that's physically obvious. And so I think it's a mental shift that we need to make in our industry and as human beings.
So Lisa, what if you do find a coworker that is in need, or you think that he might or she might harm himself? What do you suggest we do?
Great question. The best thing is to help that individual get connected with help. And let's remember, help comes in all kinds of different shapes and sizes. You're already helping, even by taking the steps that you're taking. Sometimes it just takes different kinds of help. So if you're not sure what to do, or if you feel like you've done everything that you can do, or you feel like this individual needs more, you can always dial a resource for them on your phone. This is why it's good to keep the resources in your phone, whether it's your EAP, the national resource, a local resource, especially for suicidality, and dial that number. Let the individual know that you're with, that you really care about them, but that you feel like you need to reach out so someone else can share some additional information with them. And when you dial the number, explain to the individual on the phone that you're sitting there speaking with someone and you're concerned about them because either they've made suicidal statements or they seem to be in emotional distress, and actually hand the phone to them. We do that here at PASS as an EAP. We do that not just for suicidality, but for other kinds of distress too. And sometimes just having someone dial the phone is a huge help for someone, because even that task seems like it's a little bit too much for someone who is already overwhelmed with everything that they have going on in their life.
Thank you for that. So I think we've talked about some of the symptoms. We've talked about some personal stories here. We've talked about what is offered out if you're inside our team, or if you are outside somewhere else, there are resources for help. Also, be aware of your surroundings. Be aware of the people that you're working with. Is there anything else, Lisa, that we're missing here on a high-level topics that you wanted to discuss today?
Yeah, I think another thing is any changes in behavior that you see among an individual, any changes in behavior, whether it's they're isolating, withdrawing, maybe they're talking more about the substance use that they're doing, maybe they're expressing feelings of helplessness and hopefulness. Sometimes people aren't just going to blurt out, hey, I've got this going on or whatever, and you have to look for it. You might observe it. And if you're spending a lot of time with someone or you're around someone, when you're in a leadership position, you want to help that individual be successful. And you also have the organization's focus in mind too, with safety, and you want to keep everybody safe too, and productivity. But that human aspect that Keith was talking about too, we want to take that into consideration as well as a peer. But any changes in behavior, now, not every change in behavior means that someone's having a mental health issue or in some sort of crisis or something. But if you're seeing things that are very uncommon for somebody over a period of time, even a short period of time, saying something to that individual, expressing that care, expressing that empathy you have for them, sometimes goes a long way. Because sometimes individuals don't even realize how they're showing that something's different, how there is a change in that behavior. Clinically, I've worked with individuals where somebody in the workplace has shared something with them. Hey, I noticed that you're not the same jovial self you used to be. You seem pretty short-tempered and it's been going on for a while. You're always on time and all of a sudden you're a little, you know, you were running a little late and you're absent more than you used to be. For 10 years, you never were absent one day and then all of a sudden now you're absent. It's a conversation. It's not a discipline. And I've had individuals come to me clinically and said, I had no idea that it was even that apparent that there was something going on in my life. So sometimes just pointing out to someone that, hey, I care about you and I'm noticing these things. Can I help? Is there anything going on? Or even saying, you know, we have a lot of resources available to us. A good EAP will focus on a whole lot of aspects. At PASS, we have just about 20 different services. So as an EAP, it's not just counseling. It's how can you cover some life events or some other stressors that are going on that could contribute to your mental health. So being present, being aware, observing, certainly taking action, if anyone makes any statements that you're concerned might mean some sort of self-harm or harm in general. Doing something is huge. There's also, as far as a resource, there's a video out there called I See You. It's the letter I, the letter C, the letter U. If anyone is listening that has personal assistance services at their EAP, you can find it on our member portal. But I think you can just Google it or look on YouTube for it. It's a very short video that kind of instructs you on how you can be of help to someone who's in some sort of emotional distress. And that distress doesn't have to be extreme distress, those changes in behavior, those things that you're seeing. So that can help give you some guidance as well.
And locally, one of the things, Larry, you want to talk about, you've had installed into the bathrooms. It's a card with some information. But again, these are in all of our restrooms inside the building. So I don't know the whole point behind it being in a restroom. If you could give a little bit of back end story on that, Larry, but if you could
no
explain
pun intended.
Those two things of the why it's in the bathroom and or bathrooms and what is the card?
I'd be delighted to explain that.
Okay.
I was at a workshop which was sponsored by Mental Health America of Lancaster County. They have a chapter here in the city of Lancaster. I was at one of their workshops, and these cards with the Lancaster County Suicide Prevention Coalition cards were there, and they explained that you should take these cards back to your business, have them in the bathrooms, because if someone is dealing with a mental health issue, they're more likely to take a card with them when they're in the privacy of the bathroom, when it's not out in the public where someone may see them, because of the stigma that goes along with, oh, wonder what they're dealing with. So that's why.
Okay, so that's the why.
That's why they're in the restroom.
Okay.
Yes. But part of this, I think, is very, very good, because it has in within these cards exactly what Lisa was talking about, suicide risk factors and the warning signs. Mm-hmm. So if you're on a job site with someone every day of the week, or most days of the week, and you get to know them pretty well, and you begin to notice something different, like Lisa said, take action, ask questions. I mean, I've heard it said at some of these workshops that I've attended that you're not going to put the idea of someone taking their life into their mind if you begin asking, are you considering harming yourself? But some people are slow to ask that question because they think that they'll give that idea to them, then they will carry that out. So you won't be able to plant that idea. And then there's also on this card how to help someone in a crisis. So these cards, even if you know someone who is dealing with something, you can pick them up, and there's very helpful information on these. Plus, there's a Lancaster County Crisis Intervention Hotline number on this card, the National Suicide Prevention Hotline, and also the Suicide Crisis Lifeline, the number 988. That people mm-hmm. can call. So all those things are right there in this little card that you can carry with you. So even though you yourself may not be dealing with a mental health issue, maybe you have a friend or a family member. So take advantage of these cards. Like you said, they're everywhere. They're in my office. They're in the lunchroom. They're all over the place. Mm-hmm. And the restrooms.
If I recall correctly, Larry, even at your church where you attend, you did the same thing there as a way of helping connect people with opportunities for access to resources.
Yes.
So where do we go from here? I think there's kind of two layers to that. As I see, one is as leaders, if you're in a role of leadership somewhere, focus on building a caring culture. You control your own response, but then also you have the opportunity to have an influence in the organization, whether you're leading that organization or a segment of an organization. Focus on building a caring culture and making resources accessible and being appropriately transparent, that it helps to destigmatize this topic in our industry and beyond. And I think secondly, as employees, maybe the span of influence is different, but we first of all control how do I respond and how will I conduct myself. And so being a caring influence, sharing the things that Larry just mentioned here, and then also being an advocate to your employer. It's very easy in leading a business to get caught up in the 565 things that can occupy your mind as a business leader. And sometimes we need someone outside our normal sphere to say, hey, have you thought about, can we do this? How can we do a better job? I'm passionate about this. And maybe you can help bring that to the forefront in your organization. And as difficult as those things are, I think about, well, how difficult is the conversation that I may otherwise have with the family of a coworker, whether it's in the hospital waiting room or at a memorial service? And those conversations are a lot more difficult than the ones that we may otherwise have in the workplace when we're advocating for or being a support to someone who's in a point of need.
Well, as I mentioned, I was a pastor for almost 30 years, and in the last 15 of those years, we're serving full-time as a pastor. And in the course of those 15 years, I was asked to participate in two services of individuals who chose to end their life. So I've sat with families, I've felt their pain, I've heard their questions, questions that there are no answers to. And so it would be my hope that I would never have to do a service again for someone who chose to end their life. So what I'd like to say is, like Lisa said, it's okay to not be okay, to understand that. It's okay to ask for help. This whole stigma that goes with this and this whole macho image that I can take care of myself, I got this. We need to be able to overcome that. Because when we ask for help, help is available. And when we find that help, I think it also helps to lead us to hope. And that hope, the ultimate source of hope, is in Jesus Christ. And like I mentioned earlier, everyone is searching for that meaning and purpose in life, and also for peace. And the only place you're going to find that is through Jesus. So that would be the message that I would like to share. It's okay to not be okay. It's okay to ask for help. There's help available, and our ultimate source for hope is in Jesus.
Well, thank you to all the guests for taking your time today and doing this. It is something that's very important in our industry. It's something that we are going to be talking about as much as we can. I know when I'm out there, we will keep on talking about this and letting our team members know that there are resources that they might not know about that they can reach out to. And again, if there's listeners out there, there's plenty of resources. If you suspect one of your coworkers, safety is a concern in this industry, and your brother's keeper and stop work authority, again, this is something that we would like to prevent. And if you notice a fellow team member in need, please reach out to somebody. But we would like to thank you for taking your time to listening to this podcast, the Brubacher and Beyond podcast. If you like it, please share it. Give us a little message or a thumbs up. If you don't like it, pass it to a friend. Maybe they'll like it, but keep on spreading the word. Again, this is our second season with this topic, and it's not something that's going away in our industry. And we really got to keep working at this, just like everything else. But again, thank you to my guests, and have a great day.
Thanks for listening to the Brubacher Podcast today. If you enjoyed it, please subscribe to our podcast so you can listen to the new episodes each month. Share it with your friends in the industry and those who might like to learn more about the construction industry. Feel free to check out our website at www.brubacher.net. I'm Keith Brubacher, President of Brubacher Excavating Incorporated, and we hope you found our discussion insightful, and we look forward to the next time together.